See, I gave you an example of a currency being at a premium. Let's understand it in a very simple way. What it really means is that I have to pay more for the same currency in future. It's a simple mechanism, right? Purchase price, sale price. So when I have to pay more in future for the same denomination or same value of currency, I have a problem. And this is called premium. In the sense, that currency becomes dearer with the passage of time. Next point. Let us look at same time frame, 3112 USD 1 is equal to 62. What does this mean? Just the opposite, isn't it? What has happened in this process? The dollar 1 remains. In the earlier example, I had to pay 64 for a US dollar, but now in this example, I pay only 62. What has really happened? In the earlier example, you found that the counterparty currency was dearer. It was more costly. In this case, the counter currency or counterparty currency is cheaper because I have to pay less for the same unit. Is it correct? Have you got it? This is what is called, in this case, USD is at a discount to the Indian rupee. Discount means for the same value I have to pay more or less, determines whether it's at a premium or discount. I think it's clear now. The point is, it is not only a simple arithmetic issue. When a currency is at a premium or at a discount, it's not a very simple matter. There are so many factors which influence. We have already discussed the larger picture when we talked about impact on the forex rates. Now let us come to the specifics. Why should there be a premium or a discount? Tell me. First factor is interest rate differential. What does it mean? Let us assume that Japanese yen, the rate is almost zero, and Indian rate, it's about 10%. What does this really mean? This indicates that the Japanese yen would be at a premium with reference to Indian rupee. Repeat, Japanese yen would be at a premium with reference to Indian rupee. Next, tenor. Naturally, a 1 month deal will be cheaper than 3 months deal, right? Because of the interest factor involved. Okay. Next, demand and supply. This is of course true of any commodity. Supply is more, naturally the object or the commodity becomes cheaper. If supply is less and demand is more, then it becomes costlier. This we have already discussed, balance of payments and current account deficits. Then financial and fiscal status. This is born out of the monetary and fiscal measures which I have already talked to you about. Next is regulations and restrictions. See, if there are regulations or restrictions of movement of a currency, then that currency becomes an issue. Because I cannot source that currency as desired as and when demanded. So, that could also have an impact. Then, speculative activities. We have already referred twice about this. Speculative activity means the guessing game, and it's purely what is called betting. And therefore, this can also have an impact on the premiums and discounts. And last but not the least, forex market infrastructure. We just discussed that technology has taken leaps and bounds and has enabled, facilitated forex movement very, very much. Now, if the infrastructure of one particular country is not adequate, naturally that currency will take a beating. Am I clear? Let's go to the next. Again, coming back to the point, we have got different methods of quoting. You understand what's a quote? Quote means you are announcing the deal price. Let's look at this. The first one is called direct quote. Direct quote is a case where local currency is variable. Take this example. I told you about USD with reference to INR, right? This is a typical example of a direct quote. So USD1 is equal to INR 62.30. Now what's an indirect quote? You can read it. It's where the foreign currency is a variable and Indian currency is fixed. You find that USD1 is a fixed unit and here INR is a fixed unit. Now when USD becomes a variable, then the quote is called indirect quote. And where the local currency is variable, it's called a direct quote. Is it clear? Now let's go to the next point. What is a global practice? Friends, please understand, Forex is always a matter of global practice. We need to understand that. So, having that in mind, let us understand what this means. Global practice is always in terms of USD1 is equal to the other currency, like what we saw here. This is the global practice. But then, there are some exceptions. What are the exceptions? If you take JBP, that is Great Britain Pound, there is Pound Sterling, Euro, Australian Dollar and New Zealand Dollar. Here, the quotes are slightly different. Let us take for example, if it is Euro, it is quoted as Euro is equal to USD 1.2358 per Euro. What does it mean? That means USD has become a variable and Euro is at 1. Similarly, Great British Pound, that is Pound Sterling, is equal to USD 1.5230. What does it mean? Again, USD has become a variable and the Euro and Pound Sterling are 1. That is, they are in unit. And you will find that the USD is a variable. This is an exception. What are all the exceptions? To repeat, Great Britain Pound, Euro, Australian Dollar, New Zealand Dollar, these are all exceptions to the usual method. Is it okay? Now let's go to the next slide. Friends, it is not always possible that you are able to get the direct rate. You understand what I'm meaning? See, for example, in India, you may not have a direct Australian dollar to INR rate. So what do? We have to calculate INR in terms of USD, because USD rates are available. You got it. Whereas when a currency, the rate is not available, you have to equate it to USD. Let's look at this point. USD is accepted as a global currency. We are all aware. So I would say all the currencies, almost all the currencies are linked to USD. Therefore, calculation of a currency for another in terms of rate is useful and possible through USD, which is why I have given you this example. Now let us look at Euro INR is not available. Got it? Now here we are talking about USD INR and Euro USD are available. This is how usually it happens. Now, since Euro INR is not available, I have to necessarily go through USD, USD INR, then Euro USD, then I come to Euro INR. Is it clear? We are using a cross method of multiplying. Means INR is going through USD to other currency for determining the value. Right? Next concept, fixed and floating rates. What does this mean? Fixed rate means the regulator or the government or the authority of a particular country has fixed the rate of exchange. For example, if you take China, USD Chinese yuan rate is fixed. The regulator decides the forex rate. So that is why it's called a fixed rate. In the sense, it is predetermined and held valid for a day or a week or a month or a year, depending on the principles and practice by that currency and country. Now let us look at floating rates. If fixed rates are predetermined, floating is obviously not. Am I right? So what is floating rate? Floating rate is determined by demand supply. That is to say, the market on day-to-day basis on hour-to-hour basis, minute-to-minute basis, even second-to-second basis, the rates keep moving. That is what is called floating rate. In the sense, no regulator prescribes any ceiling or floor for the rate, right? Next, let us look at next concept called bid and offer. Friends, let's understand what this means. Bid and offer rates mean buying and selling rate. Very simple, nothing complicated about it. Always remember, rates are with reference to the banks, not with reference to the customers. That is to say, if a bank is quoting a bid rate, that means that is the rate at which the bank is willing to buy. If the offer rate is quoted, that is the rate at which the bank is willing to sell. So please don't get confused. Bid and offer means buying and selling, and with reference in the perspective of the bank. Okay? Next, chain rule is related to cross rates. Now let us look at what percent per mil means. These are all what is called features of quoting in a forex transaction. Now I'll give you an example. This is a percentage, because 0.30 divided by 100. Got it? Whereas this is mil, because it contains, this is in terms of thousands. Okay? Next, what is value date? Value date is the very, very important criterion. That is the date on which, let us say, a currency transaction of USD. USD is credited in the account of a dealing bank. The date on which it is credited is considered the value date. Okay? That is why we use the word actual date of receipt of funds or credit to the account. Arbitrage, I need not explain because I have already talked to you about it. Just taking advantage of market differentials. Okay? Let's go to the next slide. The entire quote, buy, sell, bid, offer, whatever you call it, originates in this dealing room. Dealing room is nothing but a market within the bank where bid and offer rates are quoted for customers. Now, what does this mean? Meet forex requirements, transaction of the customers. I don't have to explain. Next, manage forex assets, receivables and forex liabilities, payables of a bank. What is a forex asset of a bank? Amount receivable. What's a forex liability? Amount payable. And a dealing room is supposed to take care of this also. Then, this is something very unique. Proprietary trading. What does it mean? That means the bank does not stop merely with the customers. It has got its own trading opportunity and profit opportunity. Okay? Next. A dealing room also maintains funds and currency positions within set limits and parameters. That is to say, they also maintain the forex funds required for the transaction of the bank. Then, Nostro. Nostro we will talk about in detail later on. But then, a dealing room's function also includes managing and funding of Nostro accounts. Okay? Now, a dealing room comprises a dealing desk. This is nothing but a dealing official's portfolio. A dealer can trade, a dealer can fund, a dealer can hedge. About hedging, we will talk in detail later on. Trading means, as we had already discussed, buying and selling forex. Funding is providing funds for any particular account or any particular transaction. Now, back office. What is back office? Dealing desk comprises front office. Back office comprises payments and settlements, processing of deals, and accounts reconciliation. What does it mean? A dealer enters into a transaction, enters into a deal, duty is over, responsibility is over. Thereafter, actually the funds have to be paid or received. That is being handled by back office. Then, processing of deals. Whatever the dealer does, this is a sort of a check, cross-check. And then ultimately the accounts reconciliation. That is, when you are having Nostro accounts, some reconciliation is involved. Now that is what reconciliation means. Now, this is a very strange, I wouldn't say strange, it's a very unique office. They have really not anything to do directly with forex, but something more critical. Risk management. We'll talk about risk management in detail later, but mid office takes care of risk management, then they decide the parameters. Then they take care of forex policy preparation and ultimately most important, compliances. The regulator has imposed several compliance requirements on the banks. Now it is the mid office which monitors and ensures compliances. Now let's talk about some of the regulatory agencies who are managing and regulating and monitoring the forex business in India. As I told you, RBI is the principal regulator of forex. And who does it? They have got a department called Exchange Control Department, who also perform the function of giving AD licenses. What does AD mean? Authorized dealers. Okay? Now, an authorized dealer takes the name of authorized person. Now, there are three categories. AP1, they are entitled or they are empowered to do all forex transactions, any form of forex transaction. Whereas AP2 has got a smaller role. They do what is called money changing, that is exchange of currency at the request of the customers. Like if you go to an airport, you will find some agencies sitting there to give forex for travel. Next, remittance facilitators. So an authorized person category 2 can do only these two activities. They cannot do all transactions. Now let us look at 3. 3 is even a smaller role. They have the only role of exchanging currency. Okay? Now, RBI issues its guidelines, regulatory guidelines, as master circulars and amendments from time to time. Okay? Now, this is another agency, very important agency, which is dealing with forex. Can you say what this is? Foreign Exchange Dealers of Association of India. Foreign Exchange Dealers Association of India, they stipulate the rules of forex for market operations. Then merchant rate quotations. Then delivery dates, holidays, transit period. We will discuss transit period subsequently. They also stipulate the rules for crystallization of bills. This again we will deal with separately. And last is working hours. The purpose of this organization used to bring a uniformity among all the forex authorized banks into one fold. There should not be any difference in the practices, difference in the way forex is transacted. Therefore, this is a voluntary self-regulatory organization founded and what is called participated by all the ADs, that is AP1, 2, 3. They all form part of this FEDAI, and uniformity and standardization of rules and procedures are ensured by this FEDAI. Is it okay? So friends, whatever we have discussed, I am sure you would have found it interesting and useful, and kindly see that you keep updated on all the subjects, and reading the book of the institute will be very, very useful by way of reinforcement of what we have learnt, because ultimately that's what is going to be the basis of your examinations. Am I right? So thank you once again. All the best.